Good evening, everybody. Good to see you tonight. It's time to get our Wednesday night service underway. I hope everybody had a great week so far. Hope you come expecting a blessing. Want to remind everyone that we are being recorded for the YouTube and for Facebook services. So just want everybody to remember that as we go forward and looking for a good time in God's house tonight. If you're visiting with us, we welcome you tonight. Glad you chose to come and be a part of our service. I got my little buddy Nathan Parker, helping me out tonight. He likes helping Brother Cecil, and I'm tickled to death. Let's take your hymn. We'll turn to number 185. 185. And let's stand tonight and sing. If you're listening out in the vehicles tonight, we're glad you chose to be a part of our service as well. All right, Miss Lois. Are we ready to sing now? I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now same am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me. Ever to him I cling, in his blessed presence live ever. And so true merits my soul's best song, faithful loving service to him belong. Love lifted me, love lifted me. Completely safe, he will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, he your savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. Good help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Each Wednesday evening we take up an offering to replenish our youth fund for their youth camps and so forth. And at this time, we'll do that. I'm going to ask Brother Colby Robertson if he'll pray for us.
Dear God, thank you for letting us gather in your house tonight, Lord. I pray that if anyone wasn't able to make it here tonight, Lord, you know their heart. You just see that they can get back in church, Lord. And Lord, I pray that you keep watch over our nation, Lord. And I pray that you use your mighty and will to do better, Lord. Lord, I pray that there'd be anyone walk here tonight, Lord. Brother Tim, with your mouthpiece,
speak to their
hearts.
Amen.
Amen. Let's
turn it
off. Make sure you turn it off. There you go. Good job.
All right, we got to go sit down now. Thank you. Let's sing some more, buddy. Number 145.
What's titsy?
145.
Two titsy. Two titsy.
Let's get over here to it. 145. Right there.
Titsy.
On Jordan's stormy banks, I stand and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land where my possessions lie. I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Good job.
I think Nate was planning on Noah praying.
Well, I don't know, maybe it's just me, but that's the kind of way I look at things nowadays, you know. Say amen, Brother Chuck.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, glory to God.
Glory.
All right, Brother Austin, Lisa catching on, amen.
Praise the Lord.
All right. All right. Well, at least the adults got a hold of it. Brother, the young people did or not. Amen. They all sitting back there grinning like a possum eating sawbriars. Good to be in God's house. Amen. Boy, I had a scare this afternoon. Mom and I were sitting out on the porch, and her little old poodle was out there with us, that little fuzzy thing she's got. And she ran down to the end of the porch two or three times, and I'd whistle at her, and she'd come back. Mom and I got caught up talking, or we both went to sleep or something anyway. I got ready to go in the house or something, and I called the dog's name. The dog's name's Lucy, okay? And Lucy wasn't nowhere to be found. And I said, oh, dear Lord. So I went in the house and looked. Mama went in the house and looked. And so we put the search on for her. Thank God we found her. She's up at the neighbor's house. He'd taken her in the house. It was raining this while all that rain and all that crazy stuff was going on, but I could see me sending Mom back home tomorrow without Lucy. I'd have probably been in real trouble, but
At any rate, I called Mike and Lisa. I called Lisa, answered the phone, and I said, "You got to get over here." I know she thought something probably happened to Mama. "What's wrong?" I said, "Lucy's missing." "I'm on my way." I probably told her I broke my leg. She said, "Well, we'll see you whenever they get you fixed up." Everybody loves Meemaw and Meemaw's dog, amen. But Lisa's done laid claims on that dog when something happens to Mama. She gets to go to the house. But at any rate, it's good to be in God's house. You say, "Well, why did you put all that on the internet?" Well, folks need a good laugh every once in a while, amen. After a day like today and our country and the mess that it's in, everybody needs a good laugh every once in a while. Brother Austin, make your way on up here so you can take care of your announcements. And I want to thank the church, and I'm sure he will too, for a great love offering Sunday for him and Sister Josie. I think it totaled out $902 and some change. So thank you for that. Amen.
We do want to thank you for that once again for giving a very generous church, and I'm thankful for that. Little hot, Uncle Guy. He gives me a huh. Knows better than do that to his daddy, I guess. But anyway, I had some vacation Bible school announcements that I wanted to make. The first one is, teachers, if you are a teacher of a class, I need to hand you a couple pieces of paper tonight. I know you're thinking, more paper. Vacation Bible school takes a lot of paper. So I've got a couple pieces of paper that'll help you in your adventure of being a vacation Bible school teacher this year. I need to hand those things to you so that I have to do a little less talking. So the less talking I have to do, the better it is for you. So that'll kind of cover a few things for Vacation Bible School. Also, for the parents that have children that are Vacation Bible School age, I have registration forms out front on the right-hand side of the foyer, if you're looking my way, left-hand side coming in. That small table out there, I have some registration forms. If you have a child that is coming to Vacation Bible School this year, remember that's the 6th through the 10th of July, then I need you to fill out a registration form. ASAP would be the best, just as soon as you can get it in. Because we need to start kind of getting things rolling on Vacation Bible School. It's going to be here before we turn around good. It is here. So remember that. Also, I've got the store. We do a store at Vacation Bible School, or at least we did last year. And y'all were very generous to help us with our Vacation Bible School in that aspect of it, by buying some candy and things like that. We have back there a sign-up list that gives you an idea of what we're looking for, where you can buy it, how much it will be, where we say that you can buy it from. You can buy it anywhere you can find it, but I would suggest that you take note of where we say that you could probably buy it, because Sister Jill put a pretty good bit of time into looking to try to find the cheapest place that you could find that candy that we're asking for. I've got that posted in the back on the right-hand side on our new bulletin board back there. It's the only thing on there, so you can't miss it if you look at the right bulletin board. So it's back there. So if you could help us with that in the store, that will kind of help decrease the cost for Vacation Bible School on the church, if we can do it as individuals. So please look at that. Miss Jill, you had something else? Okay. Hot off the press. The online registration will be open tomorrow. So paper is fine. If you want to hand us paper, we've got those back there already. If you would rather, we're going to have to print it out anyway, because we'll have to have a paper record. So if you want to save us a step, you can fill out the paper in the back. But if you just don't want to save us a step, you can go online and register online for your kids. But we do need them to go ahead and register. You may say, "Well, why don't you just assume that all of our kids are coming?" Well, that'd be great, but I know that not all of them are. So they should, Brother Tim, but I know that not all of them will be. So please make sure that you register your children so that we have an idea of how many kids we're going to have. Also, you're going to be seeing some posts on Facebook for those that do Facebook for Vacation Bible School. It's going to have the link to register, and it's also going to have the event that we've created on Facebook. So please share that and like it. I know you may say, well, I shared it, why do I have to like it? Liking it boosts that post, and what it means is the more likes it gets, the more people see it. Okay, so if you'll like that and share it, that will help spread the word about Vacation Bible School. So that's all my announcements, Brother Tim.
Boy, all that stuff.
Boost it, share it, like it. Wow. Couple of prayer requests tonight. Sister Dot, Dito was in the hospital overnight, Monday night, I think it was, wasn't it, Cassandra? She'd gotten dehydrated and her blood pressure had gotten critically low. She's back home. I got to get her drinking more water and less coffee. Okay, so y'all pray for her. Sister Amy was, in fact, somebody asked me about Sister Cherie today or tonight, and I told them as far as I know, and then Sister Amy come in and told me she's not doing well. Sister Cherie's not, she's to that stage in the Alzheimer's to where she's losing her appetite, has no desire to eat. And need to pray for Sister Amy and Brother Heath. They've got to make some very difficult decisions here not too far down the road concerning that. They have some options available to them. So you pray for them as they make that decision. Pray for Sister Cherie. Sure would like to see her back in the house of God again over in that wheelchair, wouldn't you? I'd really like to see her out of it. But I do know this, where she's headed, she won't need it. Amen. Yep. You still can't get into the nursing home. They're trying to set up one of them things. You've probably seen on TV where they'll bring them to the window and you can wave at them and talk to them on the telephone. So you pray for that family. And Sister Cherie, sweet, sweet lady. I'm telling you, she is one sweet lady. And then Sister Vivian Parker, I talked to Brother Wayne today. She's still having some health issues, and they're looking at doing some more tests on her. So you be sure and pray for those. We're going to have a season of prayer here in a moment. But I wanted to throw those three out at you. Sister Nancy, has anybody heard from Sister Nancy? I really had intentions of trying to see her today. I know okay. Well, was she still running fever? I know you told me, son. Okay, good. Continue to pray for her and okay. Well, Jennifer Hassel. That's Brother Johnny's daughter, okay? She's still recovering from her knee surgery. And our chicken pox patients, Maya and Emma, how's Emma doing? Chicken pox don't change her none, huh? Yeah, y'all pray for them too. I saw Maya today. She got the chicken pox, I promise you. Okay. But who else we got tonight? How's your mom doing after her surgery? She doing okay? Good. All right. Who else? Prayer request tonight. Let's remember that one. Who else? Prayer request. All right, let's remember that one. Well, that's always a good thing. I mean, I know it's hard for us, but remember the message we preached here a while back? Maybe I didn't preach it here. Did I, Brother Bert? Why the death of the saints precious in the sight of the Lord? I think I preached that here. Okay. Let's remember that. Any more? Brother Mike? Okay. How many unspoken we got? You raising your hand, Lisa? Okay. Yeah. A little girl has come to church here several times with Caitlin and our family, Renee Davis. One of her best friends is her cousin, but passed away, so you be sure and pray for her. Any more? All right, remember Brother Sonny, okay? Brother Cecil? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yep. And that's not just limited to being right as far as salvation's concerned. Okay? It's better to get to heaven than not get there at all. But you don't want to get there and have a bunch of stuff unaccounted for. Amen? Bloody hands. I wonder how many is going to show up with bloody hands. I ain't never killed nobody in my life. If you fail to warn people. Hello? If we fail to warn people, we'll have blood on our hands. My. We never know when we're going. We will stand before God one day. Any more? Not, find you a place to pray. You want to stay in your seat, you're welcome to. If you want to come find you a place around these altars, you're welcome to do that. I want to ask my son-in-law, Mike, if he will start us off tonight, and Brother Heath, and Brother Zach, and Brother Mike Marcotte to close us out. Thank you. seat, you open your Bible, please, to the book of Genesis, chapter number 7. Genesis chapter number 7. If you've ever watched your Bible as you read it, from time to time you'll find the Lord extending an invitation. He'll invite folks to do things. And I want to look at the first invitation that God issues in the Bible tonight. For mankind, you know the story of Noah and how that God found him righteous in his generation. That's, but Kent, that almost gets up there with our friend Job. That God looked on Job and asked the devil, "Have you considered my servant Job?" The Bible talks about that in Noah's generation, God found him righteous. How did that happen? Well, it's a great testimony to faith that Noah. Now, you stop and think about the monumental task that Noah was given. Brother Dale back there, he's a pretty good woodworking man. Brother Dale, even with all of the modern day tools that you have available to you now, if you could go out and equip your shop with all of the tools and gadget, can you imagine what a monumental task that would be if God come to you and told you to build a boat the size that he told Noah to build? Now, if you've ever been to the Ark in Kentucky, that thing's built on the actual scale of the Ark, the size of the Ark. How long do you reckon it'd take you to build it, Brother Dale? I'm talking about monumental tasks now. And God says to him, here's what I want you to do. And Noah demonstrates great faith. That's the reason the Bible, from beginning to end, does not teach that the Old Testament saints got saved by a different method from us. It's all based on faith in what God says and acting on what God says. So I want to read tonight, and I want to look at this invitation for a moment that God extends. He don't just extend it to Noah. Now, in a strict sense, he does. But as Noah built that ark, the invitation for the entire world was being publicized, if you will. It was being broadcast as Noah. I don't remember where it was at. I think it was actually in the ark. I don't remember one of the places we went up there, either the Creation Museum or the Ark One. If my mind serves me right, which it's very possible it might not be, but they done a little simulation, a story, a make-believe story. Brother Austin, you may remember if I'm right or wrong. I might have dreamed this. I don't know. But at any rate, they had a supposed news story of somebody covering Noah building the ark. And so whatever method was used back in that day, it may have been some TV station or newspaper or Brother Mike, one of them just said, "All right, preacher, come on." Somebody was probably in some method covering this crazy man building an ark, building this monumental structure that some crazy God, and can't you hear the news media, can you hear them today? I could hear them today. I mean, I think it was probably that way. Man hadn't changed in the 6,000 years of human history. There were skeptics then, just like they are now. There were those that ridiculed and mocked and made fun then, just like they are now. And, And then when they begin to question Noah about why you are doing it, and he says, well, it's going to rain. It's going to rain 40 days and 40 nights. And they didn't have Webster's 1828 then. That's a few days before then. So they couldn't, Brother Bert, they couldn't run to the dictionary and look up rain. And here's this crazy guy building this monumental structure because it's going to rain. And I believe Noah, as he was building, Brother James, as that thing started to shape up, and the folks had come through and ask, and of course make fun of him and ridicule him and scorn him, that all of that was God was extending an invitation to the entire world. That thing in its completed form was an invitation by God to escape the wrath that was to come. Let's read, beginning in chapter 7, verse 1. I'm going to read down through verse 7, and I'm going to move through this pretty quickly tonight. Because the Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Noah," here's the invitation, directly to his family, "Come thou and all thy house into the ark. Thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation." What a statement. "Thee have I seen righteous." Why? Because of his faith. Here he is. He's all these years he's labored building this monumental boat, Brother Bert. And God says, because of your obedience to my word, you know what that makes you? That makes you righteous in my eyes, because you've exercised faith in my word that I'm going to do exactly what I told you I was going to do. "Of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by seven, the male and his female." That's an interesting concept in our day, isn't it? A lot of folks need to go back and read that. It's still in the Bible. Amen. "And of the beasts that are not clean by two," watch, "even the unclean," what does it say? "A male and his female." "Of the fowls also of the air by sevens, of male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of all the earth. For yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Can you imagine how disgruntled we'd be? We get to complaining if it rains more than 2 or 3 days in a row. God says it's fixed to rain 40 days and 40 nights, nonstop. "And every living substance that I have made, I will destroy from off the face of the earth." Watch verse 5. Here's that righteousness. What made that him righteous in that generation. "And Noah did according unto all that the Lord commanded him. And Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters was upon the earth. And Noah went in, and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him into the ark because of the waters of the flood." Father, help us tonight for a moment as we look at this tremendous invitation that you have extended. God, I believe you're still extending the invitation, Lord, to unsaved mankind. Lord, I believe there's a flood of a different type that's brewing. Lord, I believe there's a judgment of a different type that's in the making. But yet, God, I believe you're faithfully proclaiming the invitation for folks to come into the ark. Love you. Thank you for letting us serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. Be an interesting study for you sometime to just go through your Bible and write down all the invitations you can find that God makes. A few weeks ago, we preached on that one out of Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. "Come now," he said, "let us reason together." So the Bible's full of them. It'd be good for you sometime. And God's invitations, may I say to you, are always based upon His love. Amen. We invite people to our houses because we love them, right? Let me ask you a question. When's the last time you invited an enemy to the house? And I said that to prove my point, and that being that we invite those that we love. But here you have a God, Brother Mike, that's inviting, and most of the time we invite those that we know love us. Because we know if they love us, then more than likely they're going to reciprocate. Number one, more than likely they're going to accept the invitation. Number two, more than likely they're going to turn around and invite us for something they're doing. Am I right? I mean, that's just... But here we see a sovereign God inviting people that He knows going to reject Him, and people who, in the truth of the matter is, they cannot return in kind the invitation that He's giving. So it's a tremendous story as you look at it. I want you to notice, first of all, there's an invitation to survive the flood. If you will, the judgment that man, may I say to you, man brought this upon himself. You go back to chapter 6 and look at verse number 5, the Bible says, "And God saw that the wickedness of man was..." What's the word? "Great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart..." Hey, young people, where'd we find out we do our thinking? Where? In the heart. Part of the soul, not this muscle that pumps. We do our thinking in the heart, in the mind. Okay? It's part of the makeup of the soul. That the imagination of the thoughts of his heart was what? Only evil continually. But Kenneth, I cannot help but look at the world today and say, my goodness, aren't we there yet? I mean, really, you look at the world today. You look at the great United States of America today. I had this thought today. All of this craziness that's going on, and all of the statues that are being taken down, and all the trying to remove the past history of this great country of ours. I had this thought today. I wonder when July the 4th rolls around if they're going to suggest that we don't celebrate July the 4th. You see the wickedness of Noah's time. They were wicked in their thoughts. And wicked thoughts produced, if you will, corrupt actions in their morals. Their moral, because their thinking was wrong, their moral activity just decayed. Man, where are we at in America tonight? Where did the morality go? Where did folks just good common morality wanting to do right because you nothing else because of the conscience that God put in a man to be able to identify right from wrong? Astounds me today. Violence. You read these chapters and you read that early history. Verse 12 of chapter 6 says, "And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt." Isn't it an amazing thing today? Because we pass legislation that says something is not wrong, we believe it's okay. y'all with me? You follow where I'm coming from? I mean, because we say it's okay for a man and a man to get married, then we don't believe it's corrupt. I got news for you. It's still corrupt. We pass legislation to say it's all right that a woman and a woman get married, so to speak. I'll tell you something. They're not married in God's eyes. Amen. I don't care what my wife's sitting over there cringing. She knows this is going to be out on the airways. And My mama made a great observation this morning. Can I tell y'all what my mama's observation was this morning? She didn't know Sandra's coming down the hall. Brother Mike, boy, you talking about Mama making a boy's head swell up. She said, Sandra sure is lucky to have you. I thought, thank you, Mom. What are you rolling your eyes about, youth pastor? God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. Violence. Boy, we live in a violent society. You hear me? I think to a degree it's, according to what the Bible says here, it's been that way for a long, long time, but man, what a violent society we live in today. And then verse number 7, you see judgment that's brought about because of wickedness and corruption. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping things and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. What are you trying to say, preacher? I'm telling you that God don't wink at corruptness. God does not wink at sin. God does not let it pass. Amen? It's got to be atoned for. It's got to be paid for. I'm glad to report to you today. Somebody paid my sin debt, amen. I couldn't pay it myself, and somebody volunteered to pay it for me. I'm sure glad he did, amen. Here in this verse, God says, listen, I want you to come into the ark because I'm fixing to bring judgment on the face of the earth. I mean, you got to stop and think about how heartbreaking this was for God. God says, I'm fixing to destroy everything that I created. Remember what God said about everything that He created? And God looked at it and it was good. But a few chapters later, Brother Dale, we find everything God says that man has corrupted it. He's corrupted it. He stripped it of its beauty. He stripped it of its uniqueness because of his wickedness and his sin. And we know who's behind all that, and we know that the Bible still plainly teaches that the wages of sin is what? Death. And that's exactly what God's pronouncing. But we find, thank God, that Noah, verse 8, but Noah found grace in the eyes of God. Amen. One day I'd write where all the other unsaved world's at, but thank God one day grace found me where I was at. I like that old song Squire Parsons sings, He came to me. When I could not come to where He was, thank God He came to me. He come looking for me. There may be some of you in here tonight, He's been knocking at your door. Amen? He'd been trying to get entrance into your life. He'd been wanting to gain entrance into your life. He's inviting you. He's got an invitation for you. Grace was offered to a world that was facing judgment. May I say to you, thank God tonight, grace is still offered to sinful people. If you're here saved tonight, you were saved by grace. Amen. Because God offered you grace. Grace was in this story and still is today the undeserved favor of God. That ought to make something turn over down inside of you, amen, when you get to thinking about the God that created us chose to extend grace to us and give us an invitation, if you will, to come in. Second thing that I see concerning this invitation, not only is it an invitation to escape judgment or to survive the flood specifically in this story, but it's an invitation that takes faith to respond to. Now understand this. This boat was built on dry ground. God gave very specific instructions. Brother Bert told Noah to pitch it within and pitch it without. Amen? But it was still unproven. Now, it would have been one thing if God had just said, get you and your family on there. But he said, I want you to go out and I want you to get all these animals. I'm gonna put it in their heart. You had no problem with them. This is after the fall, by the way. God said, I'm going to put it in their heart. Amen? If the king's heart's in his hand to turn it with us or every with it, you can't tell me that he can't take a line and tell him, for a few days, son, for a few days you're going to keep your mouth shut. Amen? That old venomous snake. For a few days, you're going to keep that venom in their sacks. Right? That's what God did. Hey, he did that even later. Remember when a man by the name of Daniel got cast into a den of lions? Same God told them lions, hey, boys, you taking a vacation night. You going on a, not just a fat-free diet, you going on a no-food diet. Because one of my servants is going to be using you for a pillow tonight. Amen. I believe that with all my heart. I believe old Daniel laid down on that line, probably had the best night's sleep he'd had in a long time. Amen. That fur, that nice soft fur, and that belly slowly going up and down as he's breathing. Man, he thought he was back in his mama's arms again, rocking like a lullaby. Amen. So you're crazy, preacher. Yeah, I guess I am. But I'm doing the preaching, so I enjoy it. Amen. Listen to me. Listen to me. Noah, God that created all of this, brought all of these in. But Noah had to act in faith, amen. I was talking about that boat, it had been unproven. Noah had to place his faith in the Word of God, not the works of his hands. Hello? You know what we'd have done? We would have got through. We'd have got that big old thing back, and bam, we'd have backed off. We'd have took pictures and sent it all over social media. Look at what I built. Amen. Man, we'd have been posting that thing on Facebook and YouTube and everything else. Saying, man, don't you look at what I've done? No, it didn't. He placed his faith in God's word, not in the works of his hands. Boy, if we need to understand that. That it's God that does the work. Amen. It's us being obedient to God's word that gets the job done. Noah's salvation, may I say to you, was just like ours. It was by grace through faith. Amen. He had to place faith that God, who by the way is the master boat builder. Well, no way that boat wasn't going to float. Amen? Wasn't going to sink. You know why? Because God said it wouldn't. You know where God was at when he invited Noah? Anybody tell me where he was at? He was inside that boat. He said, come on in. Amen? He didn't stand outside and say, Noah, get on there and see if it's going to work. No. God said, come on in. Somebody come knocked on your door. What do? You open the door and say, come on in. Right? Unless it's somebody you don't want in. Noah's salvation was by grace through faith. May I say to you, if I understand my Bible right, our salvation is by grace through faith. Noah was saved from God's wrath in the flood. We're saved from the wrath that is yet to come. This whole earth's in for judgment again. Amen? We're going to escape the same way that Noah did, by faith. Grace of God, the goodness of God, that unmerited favor of God is going to be what saves us. Amen? And then I want you to notice one other aspect of this story. It's an invitation to all of Noah's family. God said, I want you to come in all of your house. If I understand Acts chapter 16 right, the Bible does teach that God wants all of our family to be saved. And that's very specific in Acts chapter 16. But I know this. As it was in Noah's day, it's God's desire that all men be saved. It's not His will that any should perish. We sing that song, "Will the Circle Be Unbroken?" I'm afraid for a lot it's going to be broken. But it ain't because the invitation hadn't been extended. It's not God's desire that our family circles be broken. God desires, and He didn't just invite just Noah, He invited the whole family. Won't you just go ahead and come on in? Psalm 119, verse 9, He talks about His faithfulness to all generations. Just as He is faithful to Adam and Eve in providing redemption through them, the shedding of innocent blood, and just as he did to Noah in the great invitation for he and all of his family, amen, His faithfulness to all generations. Why do you mention about that invitation being to all families? Because, and I'll get our men again. Boy, there was some men squirming Sunday morning. You hear me? I'm talking about squirming. Our responsibility is to our family first. God said, you can bring them on board. Is it difficult? Yeah, it's difficult. But I promise you, because of God's desire for families, He'll give you the wisdom and the power to win your family to Christ. Let me give you three thoughts about that ark, and I'm going to close for tonight. The ark, number one, is a place of promise. Jesus said to some troubled disciples one day, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." The ark was a place of promise. I'm glad I got a promise today, amen. Not only that, but it was a place of protection. It was a place of protection. I heard a preacher say this years ago, I really liked it. He said when Noah built that ark, he didn't put eight pegs on the outside of it for him to hang on to. God didn't say latch hold of them pegs and if you make it through you'll be out. No. He put them inside that ark. A place of protection. There was a storm. There was judgment raging outside. But it's also a place of provision. I guess that was one of the things that I probably enjoyed. One of the things I probably enjoyed most about the ark was their conception, Brother James, of how that on board that ark there was sufficient room not only for everything that was on it, but for food and water. I mean, all of that. It's an amazing thing. Why? Because the ark was a place of provision. I got news for you today. God's still the great provider today. Amen. Man, what an invitation. You may be here tonight and be lost. May I say to you, judgment's coming. It's coming. I don't believe it's near as far away as some want to think it is. Now, if you're here and unsaved, you want to think it's a long way down the road. But I don't believe it's near or far away as we think it is. Might be a wise thing to accept God's invitation. Amen. To get into the ark. I believe, Brother Burton, it would be safe, Brother Austin, across the back of that ark for him to put USS Salvation. Amen. I mean, most boats bear a name, right? I don't know, maybe we just need to take one of them S's off. U.S., us, salvation. Amen. And stamp that on the name, because in that ark, there was safety. There was protection. There was provision. Amen. From the judgment of God. I'm glad tonight I hadn't been saved to wrath, but I've been saved from it. Amen. Father, we love you tonight. Lord, I feel an urgency tonight, Lord, just to give a moment of invitation. Lord, I may have spoke to someone's heart here tonight. Lord, they realize tonight, Lord, they're not in that place of safety. Lord, judgment's brewing. Lord, corruption is rampant, not just in America, but God, all over the world. And God, you looked at the world one day and you judged it because of its corruption. Lord, I believe we can't be very far from that place where man's thoughts were only evil continually. And so God, I pray tonight if we extend a moment of invitation, or Lord, you do, that there be some that would come tonight and say, yes, Lord, I accept the invitation. I believe what you said in your word. And God, by grace, through faith, I want to get into the ark of salvation that you've made available today. In Jesus' name. Brother Cecil, if you come, I want to sing one verse, a hymn of invitation tonight.